Hello, beautiful people. Yes, it is that time once again for Ekhaya at home in Mzansi, the beautiful rainbow nation of South Africa.
Wow, Master, I'm feeling quite fresh. You know, as you all know, women's hair is her crown and glory. So I'm ready to explore Cape Town. Let's go. Okay, now Master, I've got my hair done, but I'm a bit tempted to see what else this flea market has to offer. As you know, Cape Town's known for their shopping, so let me go and see what I can get.
You can call me Jidaja.
Jidaja, nice to meet you. Wow, this is really, really amazing stuff.
Thank you, ma'am.
How long have you been doing it for?
I've been doing it my whole life.
Really? Oh, wow, I can see. Okay, but like, I'm so jealous. I also want to get mine done.
So what to wait for?
Can I?
Just grab a seat now. We take a picture of you, friends inside, and then welcome.
Okay, great stuff. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'd love that.
Are you ready for that?
Yes,
let's go for it. I'm going to borrow you my chair.
Okay.
While we... Okay, that's good.
Okay.
You mind to stand up a little bit?
Alright.
Stand up.
Now you're probably wondering, where are you, Asanda? Well, I'm outside the Cape of Good Hope Castle, one of the first, actually the only first building ever established in Cape Town. The reason why I'm here is basically to meet up with Jadeja, who is our portrait artist. Now if you remember last time I met with him, he was at the waterfront, and now I'm here to be in his environment, in his studio, to see the rest of his artwork and to pick up our portrait. So let's go. Thank you so much for bringing me into your space.
My pleasure.
Now tell me, when did this all begin for you?
Okay, I've been working here for about 3 years already. It's like a whole huge studio that we all sharing spaces, and this is actually my space where I exhibit some of my work, and I work here every day.
But in terms of the moment you put a paintbrush to a canvas, like when did that start as you discovering that this is actually what I'm good at?
Okay, I would say it's like a few years ago. And I can't really specifically remember because it was like so excited. The first time when I realized that I was an artist. So I would say it's about 5 years ago.
Okay, but I mean, obviously you drew as a kid, way before.
Yeah, of course. I've been sketching. I would say like ever since I was in the primary school, I would always have like a sketchbook with me and trying to sketch and trying to express myself through a lot of small sketch with the pencil, either with the crayon or with anything that I can find.
So what's your medium now? Because I see more paint usage than pencil. So when did you discover the love of using paint, and what kind of paint?
I'm actually using all paint, and I'm using it on a canvas. So this is actually like my top of the range of product that I'm using at the moment. But beside that, I use like I'm like quite able to use I would say like a different media. I can work with pastel, I can work with the crayon, I can work with all on canvas, which is what I'm doing right now.
Okay, do you ever use acrylic?
It dries fast. I don't like it.
Okay, well, you should know. Now, in terms of your actual painting, I mean, what would you say you work best with? Because I noticed more portraits than landscape or any other form of expression. So why did you choose portraits?
Okay, I choose portrait because I like it real. I like it when it comes to I like painting that's more realistic. So when I first realized that I was an artist, then I first jumped into doing portrait. So I wanted it to be real, and the fact that I got that ability to reproduce something as it is, as I can see it, I can be able to reproduce it. So I take that as an advantage.
Now, specifically talking about this over here, which is your own self-portrait, what is the inspiration and the story behind this specific painting?
I would say, technically speaking, I would say first of all, I came up with this idea. It's actually like some sort of new ideas that I'm busy developing, because knowing that I'm good with the realistic, and it comes a bit of problem for people to buy or to appreciate just like a normal portrait.
So because it sort of looks like a picture.
Yeah, here we go. And then I came up with another idea. I say, and I got like, I got my figure and trying to break it down a little bit. I was much more inspired by an American artist called Salvador Dali. So seeing his work, and I was like trying to pick up what is positive in his work, and then I bring it into my work. And then I tried first with myself. I paint myself as I am, and then on the other side, I'm trying to break it down a bit. Breaking down this piece, it tells me a little bit of the struggling as an artist that we go through into our career. So it's kind of difficult to make it out there, but you just have to stick around. You may lose a little bit of yourself, but you are still there. So it's like a message for all the artists just to keep up in what they're doing. So they quite good.
Okay, yeah, because that's what I see, that, I mean, there might be pieces of you breaking away, but eventually they will eventually come back together. Is that it?
It's like going back and forward, so it's like, I would say that's it.
Well, great stuff. Now, I don't know, because I'm actually here to see our portraits, if you managed to finish, because if you remember last time, you know, you did it in 30 minutes, but to pick it up, I wanted to come see the rest of your other art pieces that you didn't showcase at the waterfront. So, do you have the surprise for me?
Yes, I got it.
Okay.
Right, oh. I'm going to show you just now.
Okay, great stuff.
So, one, two, three. Okay, you better close your eyes.
Okay.
One, two, three.
Oh, wow. So this is fantastic stuff. Can you capture that? That is great. Wow, that is so real.
Thank you.
I can actually see myself in it. That is really fantastic. So tell me, what did you use? Like, I mean, when we left you, you had already taken the picture. So what did you use to get it ready?
Okay, I first did my outline, and then afterward I work on it, and I use a pencil crayon, like a brownish tone, it's called sepia light, and then afterward I work on it, that's all.
Wow, I'm just looking at every bit of our expression. My eyebrows are there, like my hair looks exactly the same. This is amazing stuff, thank you so much.
Thank you very much, I'm actually glad the fact that you really like it.
I love it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And you know what? I hope that you continue expressing yourself through the arts, and you know, business will keep booming because you are one talented artist.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
When was this place established?
Oh, okay. I'm with the company for 10 years, which means it's older than 10 years. I think about 18, 19
years. Oh, wow. That's a long time. And it's still standing till this day.
And tell us, still doing good.
Good, yeah. What makes it so popular?
The local fish and chips. Mm-hmm. And we do it different to the normal fish shops. I think the difference is we fry as you order.
Oh, okay, so it's fresh, like you make the food at that
fried,
time.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
While brilliant. The customer wait for the order, we fry.
Oh, okay, so it's not pre-ordered or pre-made.
Or pre-cooked.
Or pre-cooked. No. Oh, that's what makes it more fresh. So tell us about your fish. Where do you get your fish from? I mean, we're right here on the waterfront. Do you fish from here?
No, we don't fish from here. No, we got different suppliers.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's not from here.
Oh, okay. So it's not literally from the
sometimes it's imported.
Oh, I see. Yeah, imported.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And how often do you ever run out of fish in terms of when you're really busy? When are you busy?
No, we don't run out of fish. We make sure of
that you've got enough stock.
That we've got enough stock, yes.
Okay, great. Now, talk about fish. You know, what would you say... What is your target market? I mean, what is it, just fish lovers, or do you get more people that are like tourists that have never had your fish? You know, what would you say are the typical people that come in here for your fish?
Typical people is the local people, mm-hmm. but we do get a lot of tourists.
Is it?
And they love the fish.
Oh, okay.
They enjoy themselves.
Yeah.
And especially during season, most of the people are tourists.
And what would you say they enjoy the most? What would you
the most common meal?
Uh-huh.
Egg and chips. Everyone loves egg and chips.
Is it grilled or fried? Nicely fried and
We sell grilled and fried.
Okay.
But if I'm in front, I normally recommend the fried because it's more tasty than the grilled.
Than the grilled. Fantastic.
I'll give you something that I normally recommend to the customers. That's a little bit of everything. That's called the mixed seafood box.
The mixed seafood box. Yes. That would be great. Thank you so much, Zaini, for having us.
Pleasure.
That is delicious. That is yum.
So I guess you're right, huh?
See, I told you, Fisherman's Choice is the best fish shop, not only in Cape Town, but in the Western Cape.
Thank you so much. You were right.
Pleasure. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Wow, okay, at least it's not as bumpy as last time when I was on the Lady J. This time I'm on Queen Victoria. But you know, last time was more about me really experiencing the route to almost Robben Island. But this time round, I'm actually going to leave you with Peter, who's going to tell you more the in-depth of the company as a whole. So yeah, over to Peter. See you later.
Hi there guys, my name's Peter. I'm the Operations Manager for Classic Cape Charters here in the V&A Waterfront Cape Town. And we've been operating for about 11 years now, doing various charters from the V&A waterfront, including fishing, shark diving, harbour tours, sunset cruises, private charters, the water taxi service that operates from the canal through to the waterfront. So just basically anything and everything that you can think of, we do. Basically the Lady J and the Queen Victoria, their main function is doing the harbour tours throughout the V&A waterfront. So it's more for the moms and dads with the little children, and they'll take you out around the harbour, show you the big ships and the seals and anything that's interesting in the harbour. Whereas Shoshaloza operates through the canal, which is anywhere between the convention centre on the foreshore in Cape Town, right through the back of the one and only hotel. You might get to see a celeb or two, if you're lucky enough. Main rush, from the V&A waterfront, there are a couple of high-speed boats that I would recommend as well. Maybe even a helicopter clip. They got a nice UE combat mission that does some low-level flying, which we can incorporate as well. And yeah, it's pretty much adrenaline filled. Cape Town, it's the place to be. We've done the World Cup a couple of months back. It was a huge success. There was no problems. A lot of tourists here. We only get good feedback from all the tourists that were here. So I would definitely recommend coming to Cape Town and having a look around. It's for everybody. Cape Town's diverse. There's a little bit of everything here.
Well, there you have it. I hope Peter has, you know, debriefed you about exactly what you can expect right here on his shores, on the waterfront. Wow, this is absolutely breathtaking. I had to stop just to take it all in. I mean, look behind me. This view is to die for. This is Cape Town at its best. Oh yeah, and take a look down there.
Hi, welcome. My name is Jo.
Thanks. I'm finally on the Shoshaloza. I'm quite excited.
That's the name. I'm going to be taking you guys for a nice trip through our canal, as you see here, and where most of our rich and famous stay.
Yeah.
And then I'll give you a little bit of a layout on the way.
Awesome.
Furthermore,
stuff.
Enjoy yourself.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
3 million per room just to build a hotel.
Ian, who is
that's out of 150 bedrooms. From the hotel. The water runs all the time. We have got a lock system.
Which hotel is the highest?
And the highest, I would say, at the moment.
Or something.
Anyway, let me quickly show you. On top of Table Mountain, remember if it's your birthday that you can go up the mountain for free.
Yes. Really?
Yeah. And every Friday, apparently, from 6 o'clock onwards till 9 o'clock, it's half the one on Friday. Everything, of course, is under camera surveillance, like here on the left post here.
Wow, thank you so much.
Give me a hug.
That was amazing. Have a Shoshaloza, I must say, it is an experience and a half. You know, you get to live like the rich for just 1 or 30 minutes. So that's, you know, that's good enough. So definitely must do. Go into the Shoshaloza. I absolutely loved it.
And
the Blue Train experience starts from the moment you check in at our VIP lounge, whether it be Pretoria or Cape Town, depending on the route that you're doing. You will get treated to the most delicious petit four. Canapés, as well as some pastries. You will then get ushered to your allocated suite, whether it be a deluxe suite or luxury suite, by a professional butler. Your professional butler will then serve the suite and also tell you about the facilities we have on board. You will then get treated to some lovely refreshments, whether it be in your own suite or in one of our public areas. Could be the observation car, the lounge car or the club car for those of you who enjoy tobacco or cigars. You will then get called to join us in the dining car for brunch. After brunch, you will then join us in the lounge car for some high tea. And I'm going to give you a little bit of the background regarding the high tea. The high tea goes back as far as the mid 1800s. where the Duchess of Bedford used to invite the high society ladies and gents to join for some afternoon tea. Now, along with that, they'll serve some scones, cucumber sandwiches, and danishes. Now, this is something that we as the Blue Train have adopted since the inception of the Blue Train. Now, after afternoon tea, you will then get invited to join us for an excursion of the Kimberley Mine Museum and the Big Hole, which showcases the diamond vault where the diamonds that have been extracted from Kimberley Mine, as well as the replicas of the diamonds that have been extracted from Kimberley Mine, are exhibited. You will then also be shown a very short film that gives you a brief history of the Kimberley Mine Museum. You'll be taken underground just to give you a feel of what it used to be like for those miners who mined the most precious stone of South Africa. Upon your return to the Kimberley station, you will then get treated to a glass of sherry served in a Blue Train sherry glass that has a Blue Train logo, of which guests are welcome to keep as a memento from the Blue Train. Later on, guests will then join us in any of the public area for a pre-dinner drink, whether it be martini, whether it be the most exotic cocktail or wine. Shortly after that, you'll then get invited to join us in the dining car for the Blue Train dining experience. We have wide variety of wine from our wine list. We have selected very carefully the wines and the wine makers that we do feature on our wine list. After dinner, you'll then join us in one of the public area or even in the club car for a lovely Cuban cigar served with Hennessy, Cognac, or Remy, whereby you can party and enjoy the rest of the evening until the wee hours of the morning. You will then retire to your lovely suite where a bed will have already been turned down. Early in the morning, the butler will then knock on your door with a tray of coffee or tea as a wake-up call. Your shoes will have been polished, your laundry will have been done. Later on, get invited for breakfast in the dining car if you don't like to have it in your individual suite. Later on, you will then also get invited to join us in one of the public areas for some snacks before the arrival at Cape Town Station, where the journey will end.
You can see I'm exclusively dressed in a Ndebele outfit. I've brought you Zulu, I've brought you Xhosa, and now it is Ndebele. I can't give it better than that. You're going to have to keep on watching to get it for yourself. Before we kickstart this exciting episode, you're going to have to sit tight until I get back. We're talking of cultural diversity, tourism at its best, diversity in each and every single sense. Where does the journey of discovery begin today? Well, Gauteng is still the province and Johannesburg, the bus city, is still the place we decided to explore. And talking about exploring, am I ever going to get tired of exploring and facing my fears? Not in South Africa, because it just has the best to offer. Having mingled with the lions, it was time to get a bit closer to the reptiles. I'm talking about the crocodiles, the snakes, you name it. But you're going to have to keep on watching to see me mingle with the reptiles and the snakes as I face my fears and become one of the bravest women probably in Africa.
Well, South Africa definitely is one of the best destinations in the world. You talk cultural diversity, you find it right here. You talk about nature reserve, tranquility, serenity of water, the big five, the list goes on and on. Bottom line, Mzansi is a very beautiful country with so much to offer. Talking about that, as moving breadth and length in Mzansi, right now I'm in Croccity, as you can see, situated right between Pretoria, which is the capital city of Swani, and Johannesburg, just 45 minutes away from the CBD, from the airport. It's right along the main freeways and highways. Come inside with me as we get to discover the beautiful and amazing world of reptiles, from snakes to crocodiles. You can only discover when you join me right in inside the Croccity, right here in Joburg, the best city of them all.
My name is Anton Lotter. I'm from Croccity Crocodile Farm, just north of Four Ways. I started about 11 years ago, so I started off as a hobby. We started off initially with about 150 crocodiles, and today we've got over 3,500 crocodiles, and there's another 2,000 babies that are busy hatching. So by the end of this year, we'll sit with about 5,000 crocodiles. And about 5 years ago, we started with the tourism section as well, so where we educate the public and the people from South Africa all about crocodiles and all the kids. So yeah, you can come and hold crocodiles and snakes and reptiles as well. You get 23 different species of crocodiles in the world. Yeah, in South Africa, you get only one species, that's the Nile crocodile that we have here. And it's on display, and they live for over 100 years, grow to 6 meters, and they can weigh up to a ton. And then in Africa, you get the African dwarf, you get slender snouted, and in America, you get your alligators and caimans. So you get different types of crocodiles all over the world. We've got such nice and beautiful snakes here in South Africa. We do have some indigenous snakes on display as well. So here you can come and see what the black mamba looks like, a green mamba, some puff adders and wrinkles. It's just to show people what our lovely snakes look like. And but we do have exotic snakes as well, so it's all your ball pythons and corn snakes, so people can come and hold it, and that are nice and safe to hold. The nice thing is we are hands-on, so we're a family-run business. People can come and hold stuff and conquer your fears. Come and hold a tarantula, come and hold a crocodile, and there's very few places where you can actually hold the stuff and come and see crocodiles and things in a natural environment. And it's a nice, fun family outing that's nice and affordable as well. This is called the Chilean rose tarantula. It's one of the most popular tarantulas to keep as pets. She's about 16 years old. The girls live for between 20 and 23 years, and they're also very special spiders to keep as well. They eat crickets and any insects and things like that. The only reason why I'm keeping my hand here, if she falls, then she dies. Because the abdomen or the bum is so nice and big, and if she falls, then the bum falls off, then she's died, then she dies.
Now you said they can live for what, 100 years?
No, these guys, they live for on average about 20 years.
Oh, about 20 years. Yeah, 20. Is this the biggest size we get?
This is the biggest they get, the Chilean roses, but you get Goliath bird eaters that get a lot bigger. It looks like a small dinner plate, and you see they can't see very well. Okay, so there's the little eyes there, and they've got fangs. So I'm gonna, if you hold this for me, then you can see I'm gonna lift it up here in the front, so you can see what the fangs look like. So there,
wow,
you
can
see the
that.
Fangs.
Uh-huh.
So lift it up again. Yeah, okay, we can see. So there's the fangs.
Okay. Do they drink water?
They don't. So they get their water from the food that they eat.
Oh, okay.
So,
all right.
So basically, what they do is they bite the food, like the cricket. They inject the venom, and the venom is actually to digest the inside. And when the inside is digested, they'll bite it again and they drink their food. So that's how they get their water.
We have seen Rose. She's very beautiful, but she cannot be dropped. If you drop her, you kill her. Now, we don't want to do that. This is called, he's going to tell you more about this. I'm holding her. It looks like a her because she's yellow and beautiful. What am I holding?
Okay, it's called the bearded dragon. And the reason why they call it the bearded dragon, because it's got a little beard. Okay, the big holes are the ears and the eyes and little nostrils, and they look mean with all the spikes. But when you hold it, you can feel it's actually quite soft. It's just to look mean.
It actually looks rough, but it's very soft.
That's what trying to tell people, listen, get away from me or they're predators. They are omnivores, so they'll eat like insects and carrots and apples and bananas. They're magic. A lot of people keep them as pets as well.
To say anything beyond what I have said will be spoiling this. I need to let you all come to the Croccity and experience it for yourself. This place is quite fun. If anything else, adrenaline rush and conquering your fears. Well, as you can see, finally, I have walked into Croccity, right situated between Johannesburg and Pretoria, one of the most amazing places. Who would have ever thought that the jungle or the wild will come in the city of Joburg? Well, Anthony's going to tell you more about that. And as you can see, I am holding a snake. I've conquered my fear, though my heart is pounding so much, it feels like I'm going to collapse. Tell me a bit more about the snake that you're holding.
Okay, the snake you're holding at the moment is called a ball python. You get them in they come from West Africa. They don't get much bigger than this, and they're called constrictors. So they don't have any venom. So even if they bite you, you're not going to die. So it's actually good to have snakes where you stay.
But now tell me about, because you do educational tours for kids as well. And I think naturally in our heads, a snake is dangerous. And I mean, that's a known factor. And in the mind alone, seeing a snake is like, I can't go close to it. And you live with them. You've been doing this for over 11 years.
Definitely. And see, we're trying to educate and tell people, listen, it's not necessary to kill all the animals where you stay. It's actually good to have snakes where you stay because they eat all the mice and the rats and the frogs. And some snakes, they even eat other snakes as well. So they've also got a purpose in life and things as well. If we want kids to hold the stuff and touch the stuff, you're not allowed to pick up any snake that you see because some are venomous, and that's why we've got some of the indigenous snakes of South Africa here on display as well. So we teach the kids and all the people that come and visit us, these snakes you're allowed to handle, these ones leave them alone, so they're not good pets and things as well.
Now you said this snake is fully grown. It looks very short as opposed to all the snakes I normally see, say on National Geographic and so forth. Tell me about this particular snake and the features. It looks very beautiful. It actually feels like leather. Now that I'm holding it, my mind has gone away from a snake because I'm holding something that feels very good.
That's it. Now, this is called a ball python. Like I said, they come from West Africa. They grow to just over 1 meter. They're very beautiful snakes. A lot of people keep them as pets because they're exotic. You don't need any permits to keep them. Another name is called a ghost python. So they've got two little eyes that looks like a little ghost. And things here on the side. I know in the UK they call them royal python. So each place they call them different names. But the most common name is called the ball python because it goes to the little soccer ball when they're sleeping. So they make very good pets.
And now how long do they actually live?
They live for between 30 and 40 years. So it's a long-term investment and things as well. So when you want to keep some snakes, read up about them and find out, do you really want the pet that's going to live for that's it. Sometimes, yes. Like a crocodile can live for over 100 years. So that's why they don't make good pets as well.
Can see I'm scared to death, but well, I'm still alive at Croccity. This is one of the biggest snakes in this place. It is not so harmful, I hope. Well, he's gonna tell us a bit more about this one. It's very thick, but it feels very, very smooth. Believe you me, my heart is pounding. I just need to get oh god. Well, you can see exactly what I mean. Please take the head. Well, one of the most amazing things with Croccity is the fact that actually most schools do educational tours in this place. As you can see, we've got this beautiful little girl right here. She's very comfortable with the snakes, and I guess most young people actually are very comfortable. Anthony's going to tell me more about how young people react, meaning that you all adults need to get here and conquer your fears just like I just did.
Okay, the nice thing about kids normally aren't scared of anything. And it's normally the mums and the dads that make them scared because we grow up being scared of things. So normally kids aren't scared of you, and you need to teach them, listen, some things you're allowed to pick up and some things you can't pick up. Alright, so there's consequences for all the things that you do. But all these snakes that we let the kids hold, they're friendly snakes and things. So we don't want the kids to get bitten. We want them to grow in confidence and let them touch the stuff. Because if they protect all the environment and things, there's going to be snakes and animals and things left for their children as well. Right, and like you see, you're holding a big snake.
I am.
Okay, this is a Burmese python. They get very big. They grow to between 5 and 6 meters. They can weigh over 100 kilograms, so they get big. And he's just smelling you. All right.
Well, that's about all I want to do right now. I'd rather go to the crocodiles, but the snakes actually feels, it feels very, very smooth. The skin is amazing. Now I'm inviting you all, make some time on a Sunday, Saturday, come out here to the Croccity, located just in between the city of Tshwane, which is the capital of South Africa, and Joburg, the bus city. I'll be seeing you with the crocodiles. I've had my fun, though still very scared. Catch me with the crocodiles. Well, finally, you can see I'm outside. The place looks very, very beautiful. I'm on a beautiful bridge. Under me, there are actually two crocodiles. The place is very, very safe, so no fear factor this time. You won't fall in. It is quite safe, and you can just stand around here, gaze at the crocodiles as they're being fed. Now he's going to tell us a bit more about the crocodiles this side, how long they've been here.
Okay, so these ones that you see here, they've been here for a couple of years. Their ages varies from between 40 and 60 years. So these are some of our breeding stock. Crocodiles, they can live for over 100 years, grow to 6 meters, and they can weigh up to a ton. So the average size crocs in here, they're from 3.8. The biggest ones in here is about 5.2 meters.
So how often do they eat?
Because they're cold-blooded, they don't need to be fed every day. So on Saturdays and Sundays at 2 o'clock, we've got feeding times. So that's quite nice and special to come and see. Then there's a lot more movement, because when you throw the food up out down to them, they'll all come running for it. So it's actually quite nice to come and see the feeding.
And now I see you've put them in blue water, and I see the one right down there has its mouth open. How do you, is this to maintain the temperature or just chilling?
Okay, so the blue stuff that we put in, it's basically a product that we add to the water, and it's non-toxic. So you add it to your water and then don't get any algae that grows in your water. The reason why they lie with their mouths open is because they can't sweat like we do. So by lying with their mouths open, it's a way to try and cool down. It's almost like a dog panting. So that's how a crocodile cools their body down. And if that doesn't help, they'll go back into the water, go for a swim.
Now we're going to go see, I believe, the youngest ones you have. Will be the older ones. We can go see the youngest ones, I guess. But the behavior is the same between the young and the old, I guess.
Yes, so the bigger ones are a little bit more aggressive because they can eat you up. And the smaller ones, when you go into the enclosure, they will go into the water. So the bigger they are, then they'll see you as food. And the small ones, they see you as a threat. So that's why you need to be careful. So what we've got here, three ponds. We can see like the two-year-old ones. You can see ones that are between 6 and 8 years old. And you see the nice big breeding stock as well.
Well, you have had it for yourself. Follow me as I get to see the younger crocodiles and still enjoy myself at this beautiful place. You can have a picnic here, whatever you name it. Just come Saturdays and Sundays as you head to see the action of this crocodiles being fed. Join me as I go along. Thanks. Well, as you can see, I'm holding a baby croc. Apparently, this is only 1 month. I just learned a few things. Actually, they've got 66 teeth. When one tooth falls out, the other one can actually just immediately follow up and come in. Well, unfortunately for us human beings, when teeth fall out, they are out. For these guys, one tooth out, the other tooth comes in. He falls fairly light, but I'm told that I must not put my finger close or inside his mouth because already he can break a pencil. That is how sharp their teeth are. Ah, beautiful eyes, as you can see, very beautiful skin and still very harmless, I should say. And the bigger ones, the bigger they get, the more dangerous they are. But for now, I am safe just holding it like this. Well, what more can I say? This has been exceptionally breathtaking. Coming one-on-one and conquering your fears, I think, is the biggest achievement ever. I've seen the crocodiles. I have held a snake, or rather held snakes, as you got to see. And it's been quite amazing. I'm inviting you all beautiful viewers in South Africa, across Africa. When you do come to Joburg, please do make time to come out to the Croccity. It is beautiful, very peaceful. And more than anything else, you got to learn so much about these reptiles. Not every reptile is harmful. You can learn and teach your kids not to run away every time they see a snake. But at the same time, being educated, they know touching a snake without making proper research could be dangerous. Until we meet again, as we're still exploring the beauty of South Africa, Mzansi, stay tuned to Ekhaya in Mzansi. Was that brave or very brave?
Well, when you get to South Africa or you start exploring South Africa, you may just discover how brave you are, because there is just absolutely everything to discover. All the journey of discovery is absolutely wide and very, very long. Too many places to go to. And talking of many places to go to, I did say nine provinces, and yet we've been in Gauteng. Guess what? We decided to cross over to the mother city, Cape Town, at its best, regarded to be among the best 8 cities in the world. I cannot give it to you more than this. Stay tuned. Don't go away. Don't touch that dial. Keep on watching Ekhaya at home in Mzansi. Know you love this show, and I love it even better because I get to explore this exciting South African tourist attractions all across the nine provinces. But there is something even more special for you that I know you probably love more than you love me in this show. That is that time again where I have to leave and you stand a chance to win the most luxurious trip to Cape Town on the Blue Train, one of the best luxury trains all over the world. From the city of Tshwane, the capital city of South Africa, all the way to Cape Town, the mother city. Well, you're going to have to keep watching this screen as I get off for you to stand that beautiful chance of becoming one of the tourists in South Africa exploring the beautiful destinations. Let's meet again next week at the same place, and stay blessed.
I'm going to take you back to the Blue Train experience.